What is up, everyone? Michael here, bringing you another video today. And today, I'm so excited to be finally sharing the first episode of the Roundup with you guys. Now, this wasn't always planned to be the first episode. I do have another episode of the Roundup coming out, I want to say next week? Next week. Yeah, for sure. I'm looking at the calendar right now. It'll be good. It'll be clear. Next week, you'll get another episode of the Roundup, which will be the standard version of the show. So I'm not going to really explain that here now because we got Oscar movies to talk about. What these roundups are designed to do in simple terms are just allow me to kind of share my thoughts about a film or multiple films without having it have to have like a score or a number or, you know, things like that. And I hope that my words will showcase enough of my feeling about a movie where I wouldn't have to give you a score anyway. And if you are that eager or that in need of a actual star or a score, you can go on my letterbox as always at Michael Chu, and I give scores there for most movies. So without further ado, I say we start this episode off with our first Best Picture nominee. Yep, hold up a second. One more thing I forgot to mention before we begin. I am not a movie critic. I just love films. I love watching movies. I have a huge passion for film. And by no means am I a professional, but we're gonna have fun and see how it goes. That's the PSA. Now we can start. So Don't Look Up has a monster cast. It's directed by Adam McKay. It stars Jennifer Lawrence, Leonardo DiCaprio, Mark Rylance, Meryl Streep, Jonah Hill, Timothy Chalamet, Rob Morgan, Tyler Perry, Kate Blanchett, and the list goes on, so on and so forth. I cannot believe I'm sitting here talking about this movie in the context of a Best Picture film. And I want to make it clear before I get too deep into this video that I don't hate any of these movies. This is for sure my least favorite of the bunch, but I don't hate it. It is just not for me, I don't think. And it was a very frustrating film for me to watch. I'll start with the positives first. I really enjoyed the performances from Mark Rylance and Kate Blanchett. I thought they were the most in on the joke and it was working, whereas everyone seemed to be just trying to outdo each other. And I feel like that's kind of Adam McKay's attitude when he's approaching this movie, trying to like wag his finger in your face, tell you, no, I know better than you. And it is just not fun. I was entertained throughout the film, just watching, I guess, like new stars come in, Leonardo DiCaprio having breakdown after breakdown, especially given the context of his character. Him and Jennifer Lawrence are trying to go on this press tour, basically over it's an extensive period of time. They're going on this press tour before this meteor hits, and no one's taking them seriously. No one's believing them, and that's where a lot of the humor, or the attempts at humor, I should say, are generated from. And it just kind of feels repetitive after a while. You get one good, almost good, maybe even joke from every single person that enters the movie, and they exit just as fast. And yeah, I don't know. I find it puzzling that this movie is even up for debate against the other movies we're about to talk about. It's not horrible by any stretch of the imagination, but it is just so mundane and just like so average. And I feel like if it weren't for this cast, I would not like this movie. I feel like the talent involved helped not only sell the movie, but it definitely, the talent involved elevated the material. If I could say that in as polite a way as I can. I feel like in lesser talented hands, the dialogue would have sounded even worse. And in saying that, I'm a huge fan of Jonah Hill, and I feel like he was the worst part of this movie. He was so frustrating and annoying, and I understand that is the nature of his character. But to what point do you stop making this character just like go back and forth and argue with everyone? Like, at what point does that stop being funny? You know, at what point is that no longer funny annoying, and it's just annoying, and you're sitting there in a movie theater watching this? And I think I'm giving this movie maybe a higher praise than I would if I watched it at home, because I did actually get the pleasure of watching it in a theater. I'm not sure I even would have finished this if I watched it at home, to be completely honest with you. In saying that, though, the ending is the best part of this movie. I really wish that Adam McKay stuck to the tone that he captured in those last like 25-30 minutes, because it really engaged me, and I found a lot of my enjoyment of the movie to be in that last 30 minutes. But yeah, I think that's all I got to say about Don't Look Up. I feel like if you are a fan of Adam McKay's, you will probably enjoy this at least a fair amount. Probably more than I did. And especially if you are more of a Vice over Big Short person, I feel like this is more tailored to that humor that he was going for in that movie versus the elements of humor that he used in The Big Short. But yeah, that's Don't Look Up. It's on Netflix. Watch at your own discretion. On to the next. I also got to see theaters a while back in Dolby, actually. If you're familiar with AMC, it is like the bigger than IMAX, bigger speakers and bigger screen and things of that nature. I'm not sure how much of a difference that made. I just like to give full disclosure of the experience I got to have before telling you what I thought about the movie. And yeah, this is directed by Kenneth Branagh. It's a semi-autobiographical film, I believe. About his time growing up in Belfast, a very tumultuous time. And basically his father, played by Jamie Dornan in this film, has to kind of decide what's the next move for this family. And him and his wife, played by, I want to say her name, or try my best to, Catriona Balfe, I want to say, who's excellent in the film as well, kind of going through this struggle. Also, while you get to see the world through this child's eyes, Buddy, which I guess is the surrogate for Kenneth Branagh, and his experience getting to fall in love with films and getting to have crushes and just be a kid. And this movie is just really sweet. It wasn't anything spectacular either. Definitely better than Don't Look Up. I enjoyed it a lot more. And Kenneth Branagh, man, he utilizes the black and white so expertly in this film, and that was one of the things I was kind of hesitant about going into it, or cautiously wondering about, was what's the purpose of the black and white? Obviously, it takes place, I believe, in the 70s, but it doesn't have to have black and white. They made it work. They made it purposeful, which I appreciate a ton. I hate when things just kind of fall into a trend and try to just be cool or do something different when it has no purpose in doing that. But yeah, Kenneth Branagh did a great job. He, behind the camera too, so many interesting shots. Cinematography is great. For a movie of this nature too, or just a lot of dialogue, he got some cool inventive shots in there. And I gotta give huge props too to Judi Dench. I mean, her last couple of scenes in this movie absolutely broke me, and I was not expecting that. It gave me a huge emotional response at the end. That's the thing, is throughout the film, I couldn't really connect with the rest of the characters. It was kind of just watching moments, watching nice moments, watching familial moments, watching moments in the community, and watching moments of terror, too, which are handled expertly, and the sound design in those scenes are crazy. But I just couldn't, apart from those few scenes, I mean, I feel like every character kind of gets their moment, a scene that you're meant to latch onto or relate to. So everyone is going to be walking out of this movie relating to it in some way, in one way or another. And that's okay. Like, sometimes you just need to watch like a clean, simple, nice, sweet movie like this. And that's what Belfast is. Like I said, it doesn't click with me entirely, but for what it is, I found it to be very, very sweet and endearing and an easy watch, and I'm not complaining about it at all, because, I mean, Kenneth Branagh, you could tell he put his heart into this movie, for sure, as did the rest of the cast. And bringing up Jamie Dornan, oh my goodness, dude, first of all, a stud, but dude, just singing in this movie. I don't know if that's his real voice or not, but that's how they've marketed this entire movie for as long as it's been talked about, is that one scene of him singing Everlasting Love, and it's as fantastic as you would think, and that's his moment, you know? And it's a movie made up of a bunch of moments, a bunch of sweet moments, like I said, and I definitely recommend it. I think this is the type of movie that is so inoffensive you could probably show to anybody and they'll think it's at least okay. And that's just my honest opinion about it, you know? I can't give it too high of a praise just because, like I said, it didn't engage me entirely throughout the entire runtime, only in a few specific scenes. And even in those scenes, there's no real build to those moments. They're amazing moments, amazing, amazing moments, but a lot of the time there isn't really a build to them, especially... Oh, I, you know what? No spoilers. We're going to stay away from spoilers, but you get what I'm saying. But yeah, Belfast.
You know, I think if you're in the mood to watch something with your family, something relatively tame, it does have some intense scenes, but something, you know, on the more mild side that everyone can enjoy, this is the perfect movie for that. This is a great family film. Once again, this is kind of like the same scenario as Don't Look Up, where... Less so, for sure, but to an extent, I it's kind of hard to compare these two movies with the rest of the movies we're going to talk about. Once again, much better than Don't Look Up. This is still a really good movie, and a really special one. I can't imagine being from Belfast or being familiar with that area and then watching a film like this. It must be amazing. So, you know, props to Kenneth Branagh for you know, showing his story and... Those scenes where, you know, you get to see Buddy watching film and stuff is just so exhilarating. It reminds me of when I was a kid. So I respect the heck out of this movie. I enjoyed it. I think most people will too. Easy watch, for sure. Nothing crazy, nothing spectacular, but it's a solid movie. But on to the next.
So, The Power of the Dog is a Jane Campion film, starring Benedict Cumberbatch, Kirsten Dunst, Jesse Plemons, and Cody Smith McPhee, and I kind of don't really want to talk about the story of this, really, because I went into this completely blind. I watched it at home, I didn't get to see this in theaters, just saw it on Netflix, and in watching it, the experience of watching it, I didn't get a ton out of it immediately. But in sitting with it, this movie is kind of getting, you know, it might be odd to say under my skin because it's not necessarily like a horror film. There's definitely a psychological element to the movie, like a mind gamey element to the movie. But yeah, it kind of just unnerved me, and I've thought about it more and what the movie is trying to say. What the conclusion of the movie is saying. And yeah, what a smart film. I always respect slow burn cinema. I've shared that so many times on this channel, how much I can appreciate movies that really take its time. And this is one of those, without a shadow of a doubt. The first hour really, for better and for worse, really lets you sit with those characters. And I didn't feel the 2 hours necessarily, but I definitely felt how slow the first half was, but overall the 2 hours went by so fast, and by the time we get to the second half, it makes you look back on the first and realize how fundamental that was into creating the rest of this story. Benedict Cumberbatch is an absolute force in this movie. I've never seen him play a role like this, and he is horrifying, truly. There are scenes in this movie where this dude is horrifying. There are scenes in this movie where you just feel so bad for this guy, and it kind of is this back and forth, and that ties into other characters in the story too. Like I said, I really don't want to spoil this or talk too much about the story, and it's hard not to, especially because of so much of what I find interesting about this movie is in regards to that ending. I think looking back on how the film played out, it is so rewarding how the film wraps up, truly, and I think this is a movie that on a rewatch I'm gonna love. My opinion on it is gonna change drastically, and I think I may eventually make a video about it just because this is just so different. Like, we don't see movies like this right now, and I know I'm putting this kind of low on this Best Pictures list, but just because I think I need time to sit with it some more before I decide to rewatch it one or. And I think I also need to sit with it to really let all of it kind of sink in, because it's a lot. It's a really heavy movie, and you know what? I want to give credit to Kirsten Dunst and Jesse Plemons, who are an off-screen couple. It translates so well in this movie. They have a very tense relationship for a lot of the film, but you could feel the love there, that they're trying to do the right things in these scenarios. And Cody Smith McPhee, I mean, oh my goodness. This is the first time that he's really, really impressed me. I've always enjoyed him as an actor, but he is phenomenal in this movie. The subtleties in his performance are amazing. And I mean, in everything, the visual storytelling of this movie is just so good. And I've seen some people say it's like a little over the top or a little bit on the nose, and I get that for sure. But I kind of just enjoyed the way it all tied in back together. I really enjoyed the way every little piece of it felt like it was necessary to tell the story. And to learn about the characters. You learn so much about the characters in those silent moments of looks, of just movements when they're doing certain things. And once again, I know I'm sounding extremely vague when I'm talking about this, but I just don't want to spoil it for you guys if you haven't seen it. So maybe I will just make a video about this one day. Yeah, let's just not talk about it for now. It's a good movie. Really good movie. Sorry, last thing I'm gonna say. Johnny Greenwood's score for this movie, one of the best of the year. It's been playing in the background as I've been talking about this. Super, super amazing. From moment one. So that's the last thing I want to say about Power of the Dog. Let's talk about the next movie. So the next movie we're going to be talking about is King Richard, directed by Ronaldo Marcus Green. Stars Will Smith in the titular role, and this is a movie about the coach and the father, Richard Williams, but also his two prodigy daughters, Venus and Serena, who most of you, I'm sure, know are two of the greatest tennis players of all time. And this only captures a small portion of their life in their youth. I think it takes place over the course of a couple years over their youth, and smart choice to focus on that. I really enjoy when biopics don't try to fit someone's whole life story into 2 hours. And this is a little bit over 2 hours. It's 1:45, I think, so probably around like 1:30-ish, not including credits and whatnot. And surprisingly, after like the first 20 or so minutes, I got into the film big time, and I was dreading the runtime, if I can be completely honest. But I think the choice to focus on just a segment of their lives prior to them becoming like the legends that they are today, great choice. It really let us spend time with their characters as they were developing, so you're kind of getting to know them as they're getting to know themselves as they enter this new world. And the performance by Will Smith and his portrayal of Richard Williams, I think, is fantastic. I think the only complaint I have about that is that, minor spoiler, there are parts of the movie where they kind of bring up his past, and it's just in passing during very intense scenes sometimes, and it feels like that. I understand that this film isn't about this gentleman, but these moments feel unnecessary by the end because they are explaining true things that have happened in this man's life prior to him becoming the father of Venus and Serena Williams, but they just feel touched upon, never to be brought up again, just so the fact is included in the movie. And there are a couple of scenes in the movie that feel that way, but thankfully, you know, most of the focus later on in the film is on Venus and Serena, and it's better off that way, for sure. The screen time balance between the three is fantastic. And I want to give a shout out to the two young actresses that played the twins, Demi Singleton, who played Serena, and Sania Sidney, who played Venus. Fantastic jobs. I'm not sure how their resumes look prior to working on this, how their filmographies look prior to working on this, but they were both stellar. And not to mention Anjanue Ellis, who plays Orsine, the mother of the twins and the loving wife of Richard Williams. She is a silent force throughout the first half of the movie, and then once she gets her time to really voice her opinion, I mean, chills. I actually got chills watching this movie, and I was not expecting that at all. And yeah, for a biopic, I just found this to be really riveting. I was very surprised. I found the tennis scenes to be really, really intense too, which was also surprising. I'm not a huge tennis fan, sorry to say. And yeah, I just thought it was a sweet movie. It took the conventional elements of a biopic and allowed us to sit with these characters in an isolated period of time, get to know them a little bit more, and it worked out for the better. And not to mention two great supporting performances from Jon Bernthal and Tony Goldwyn. both great. I'm honestly really surprised that John Bernthal hasn't gotten really any award recognition for his role as Rick Macy, the coach of the Williams twins. He did a phenomenal job. And the scenes between him and the twins and him and Richard were some of my favorite sequences in the movie as well. Both full of laughs and some really hard-hitting dialogue that I wasn't expecting. And just a lovely spirit. I feel like his character, the twins, Orsine, and even Richard, all and their other siblings too, of the Williams sisters, all blend together to create this kind of warm feeling that kind of permeates even the darkest moments of this film. And when it starts, it is very, very dark. I was surprised by that. And yeah, I just found it to be a really, really good biopic, a really solid biopic. Not saying it's one of the best I've ever seen by any stretch of the imagination, but it is very, very good. Especially, like I said, over that runtime, it didn't feel super long. That in itself is a feat, especially in the day and age where we've been sitting in theaters for around 3 hours every time we go to see a movie now. So yeah, I definitely recommend King Richard. I enjoyed it quite a bit. Now it's time for the next movie. Okay, y'all. Drive My Car is in this spot on the list, and I'm mentioning that here just so you know its placement in my mind in terms of where how I felt about it. I liked it a lot, but I won't be talking about it here only because in a couple weeks, maybe a little bit less, I'm going to be releasing a video talking about the best international features, the films nominated for that, this being one of them, and another one being The Worst Person in the World, which I cannot wait to talk to you all about. So yeah, I'll save my thoughts for then. I just want to say Drive My Car is great. It's a very smart movie. I mean, so much of it went over my head while I was watching it, that when it finally dropped back on HBO, I just started picking little scenes and just going back and checking them out. And man, it's a really rewarding movie. It really earns the 3 hours, and I'm so happy I got to see it in theaters and with the crowd, which was crazy. I could not believe that it was a full theater in Glendale, California, watching a 3 hour long Japanese film. It was a sight to see. Yeah, Drive My Car, it's great, y'all. And I know it's not for everyone, but I would recommend just giving it a shot and riding with it. See how far at least you can go along with it. I think it offers something so unique and different in its structure, and what the movie focuses on for long durations of time, I think is really interesting, without spoiling it. So please, I'll definitely implore you to check it out, and definitely check out my best international features video when that comes out so you can hear more about my thoughts on Drive My Car. All right, y'all, I am recording this literally super duper late the night before. It's already Sunday. It's already Oscar Sunday when I'm recording this portion right here. But I decided to split the video into two parts, because one, I had problems processing the really long version, which ended up being around 50 minutes. And then two, I feel like this is way more accessible to split it up into two parts. Gives people a chance to watch this video, take a break, gives people a chance to watch the other video maybe after the Oscars, before, you know, make it more digestible, make it simpler for everybody, including myself, other than the fact that I'm up super late right now. But other than that, it's chill. I hope you guys enjoyed this first half of the first episode of the Roundup. Please leave any feedback below and let me know what you guys thought of the first 5 movies we covered. I'd love to chat with you in the comment section below, and then all my social medias are in the description as well. Talk to you guys soon. Say peace.